Begin, I wish to place on record our gratitude to all the functionaries and personnel in the government, the private sector, banks and other financial institutions who risk their lives on a daily basis by going to work or by working from home to fight the pandemic by keeping essential services fully operational. Our deepest appreciation goes out to doctors, healthcare and medical staff, police and law enforcement agencies who are at the front line. In the RBI, I would like to specially commend and thank our team of 150 officers, staff and service providers who are in quarantine away from their families and are at work 24/7 to keep essential services such as currency in circulation, retail and wholesale payments and settlement systems, reserve management, financial markets, liquidity management, financial regulation and supervision, and a host of other services available so that the nation may survive COVID-19. Banks and financial institutions have risen to the occasion and have ensured normal functioning. Their efforts are praiseworthy. I would like to thank my colleagues in the Reserve Bank of India who set aside personal health concerns and joined me in fashioning the array of measures taken by the RBI in the context of COVID-19. I also thank our teams for their intellectual support, analytical work and logistical arrangements. I would first like to highlight or give our assessment of the current economic situation. Since March 27, 2020, when I spoke to you last, the macroeconomic and financial landscape has deteriorated precipitously in some areas, but light still shines through bravely in some others. On April 14, the IMF released its global growth projections, revealing that in 2020, global economy is expected to plunge into the worst recession since the Great Depression, far worse than what had happened during the global financial crisis. The IMF's economic counselor has named it the Great Lockdown, estimating the cumulative loss to global GDP over 2020 and 21 at around $9 trillion, which is greater than the economies of Japan and Germany combined. Within this downturn, the projections are replete with even sharper declines in output in various countries. India is among the handful of countries that is projected to cling on somewhat tenuously to positive growth at 1.9%. In fact, this is the highest growth rate among the G20 economies as estimated by the IMF. The World Trade Organization sees world merchandise trade contracting by as much as 13% to 32%. I repeat, 13% to 32% in 2020. Global financial markets remain volatile and emerging market economies are grappling with capital flows and volatile exchange rates. Crude oil prices remain in a state of flux despite the agreement on production cuts by OPEC plus countries. For 2021, the IMF projects sizable V-shaped recoveries, close to 9 percentage points for the global GDP. India is expected to post a sharp turnaround and resume its pre-COVID, pre-slowdown trajectory by growing at 7.4% in 2021-22. Over the last 3 weeks, there have been a few data releases on domestic developments, but they are too disjointed to allow a comprehensive assessment of the state of economy. Yet, there are a few slivers of brightness among the encircling gloom. In my statement of March 27, I had referred to continuing resilience of agriculture and allied activities on the back of all-time highs in production of food grains and horticulture, with huge buffer stocks of rice and wheat far in excess of the buffer norms. By April 10, pre-monsoon kharif sowing had begun strongly with acres of paddy, which as you know is the principal kharif crop, up by 37% in comparison with the last season, that is in comparison with the kharif of 2019. States such as West Bengal, Telangana, Odisha, Assam, Karnataka and Chhattisgarh are leading in sowing activity despite the lockdown. On April 15, the India Meteorological Department IMD forecast a normal southwest monsoon for 2020 season, with rainfall expected to be 100% of the long period average. These are early developments and they bode well for our rural demand, supported as they are by accelerating fertilizer production, which was noticed up to February 2020. The robust growth of 21.3% in tractor sales up to February 2020 as against a contraction of 0.5% in the corresponding period of the previous year may provide an offset to farm labor shortage on account of the lockdown. In other production sectors, the situation is more somber. On April 9, the index of industrial production for February was released, showing that industrial output accelerated to its highest rate in 7 months. The impact of COVID-19 is not yet captured in these prints. So therefore, there is no reason to get misled by the IIP data, which was released up to February, because the impact of COVID-19 comes thereafter. More tellingly, however, the revival in electricity generation, a coincident indicator of demand that had commenced from January 2020, has been halted by a sharp fall in daily demand in the range of 25% to 30% after the lockdown announcement on March 25th. Automobile production and sales